Who's at fault for the Cowboys' 28-point loss to the Cardinals?
Man, there's so many people to sit here and blame, but it's very easy, man. It's Ezekiel Elliott. It's very, very easy. And I'm glad that he went to the podium with his chest out, and he said, I'm sorry, but sorries don't bring back wins nor losses, Zeke. So, and Zeke, and let me tell you why, Marcellus. Why? To whom much is given, much is required. Mm. Zeke, you were given a lot as far as draft status. You were given a ton as far as money capital. Mm. Much is required from you. Zeke, I not only need you to be the best player. Mm. You surely can't be an average player. Mm. But what you absolutely cannot do is be the worst player.
Worse.
And when you look at all the people who are to blame in this Cowboys game, Zeke was the worst player on offense. Literally. And my biggest issue, Marcellus, is I hate when players like you hold out for all your bread. Do that. I'm a co-sign you getting your bread now.
Eat.
But when you get your bread, you can't disappear. Mm. Now, so many people are going to say, well, what about Mike McCarthy? He's the head coach. The blame should fall on him. Mm. What did we all say going into the game? What should the Cowboys do?
Run the football.
Run the football. The first seven plays in the game either went to Zeke or were targeted to Zeke. The first seven plays in the game. 11 of the first 14 plays for the Cowboys either went to Zeke or were targeted to Zeke. Mm. Two of the first 14 ended in fumbles. The only reason they stopped feeding Zeke was because he fumbled his way to the bench.
Stop dropping the spoon.
So off my first lap, my first layer, it's unequivocally, beyond the shadow of a doubt, if you have to put it on one person, you got to put it on Zeke.
You have to put it on Zeke. Echo, because I'm going to say the worst, the culprit, the reason is Ezekiel Elliott. Oh, my God, a team built for Zeke to eat now can't count on Zeke. Mm. Think about that. One play can change a game. Mm-hmm. You know how we saw a pick six in Tampa Bay, Green Bay game when they were down 10-0 all of a sudden? That game changed completely. The complexion of it changed. We saw 38 points unanswered by a team that was down 10-0. One play can change the game. How about two plays? How about consecutive fumbles, Zeke? That changed this game. Zeke has now lost four fumbles in these six games, more than all the top 10 rushers in the NFL combined. Zeke, my people out there in Dallas, I still got some people out there in Dallas, you know, a little property out there, you know what I'm saying? Because I played in Dallas, a little cup of coffee. People are saying Zeke is now slowly challenging me for the worst contract in NFL history in Dallas. Come on, Zeke, you can't be playing like this. Seriously, all four of his fumbles this year turned into touchdowns, points against this defense. His last 14 games, only two over 100 rushing yards. When I look at Ezekiel Elliott, I'm going to give you some dirt on Ezekiel Elliott. 3 weeks ago, I was talking to a household name that plays in Ezekiel Elliott's division. Mm-hmm. And 3 weeks ago, the homie was saying, hey, what do you think's wrong with the Cowboys? And I said, quiet as kept, I think it's Zeke. And I came on here starting to say, look at the regression of Ezekiel Elliott. He started to scream on the phone. Hey, come here. Listen to this. Marcel, say it again. I said, I think it's Zeke. I told you. It is now widespread knowledge amongst those active players that Ezekiel Elliott has lost something off his fastball. Now, when you look at Ezekiel Elliott, you still say, hey, feed Zeke. I'm getting a little tired of that because Zeke, you got to think about it. He has had 18 or more carries in eight of his last 14 games, despite only having two over 100 yards. All of that adds up to Ezekiel Elliott, where we drafted you and where we paid you, is nowhere to be found in your talent production.
And real quick, because I'm going to pour it on Zeke before I transition to other things.
Yes.
Zeke, you can't call to be the guy and not be the guy. Mm. Zeke, you have a tattoo. You just got a tattoo that quite literally says, feed me.
You've been eating it.
You got it imprinted on your body. Imprinted. Talking about feed me. How? How dare you have something begging to get the ball, but when the Cowboys give you the ball, you don't do anything with it. That, to me, it's just, I'm disgruntled at the fact of, you gonna go get ink. You can't reverse that.
Unless you get some, like, laser removal treatment.
You can't reverse that, bro. But now, let me transition, because so many people watching are going to say, well, Acho, what about the Cowboys' defense?
Okay.
Cowboys' defense is terrible. Yes, I know that. You know that. You know that.
Everybody.
We all know that.
Yeah.
Fool me once, shame on you.
Mm.
Fool me twice, shame on me.
Mm.
I'm not mad at the Cowboys defense.
Okay.
I'm not. Because we all know they sorry.
Mm.
They told us they were sorry. If somebody shows you who they are, believe them. I'd be mad if the Cowboys defense was playing tight the whole game and then broke at the end of every single game. So it was a little Jekyll and Hyde. We don't know if they're good. We don't know if they're bad. No, no, no. We know the Cowboys defense is bad. Because we know this defense is bad, adjust. Zeke, you know they're bad. You know they can't stop a team if y'all turn the ball over. You now have the responsibility to not turn the ball over. Is that unfair? Absolutely. Is life unfair? Absolutely.
Mm.
Is professional sports unfair? Absolutely. So y'all at home saying, well, that's not fair. The game of football ain't fair.
Yeah.
Life ain't fair. You know what you're dealing with defensively. I'm not even mad at the defense anymore. Now I'm just mad at the offense.
You don't have to be mad at them, but you still can't let
them. Sorry still. They still sorry.
Okay, we can't absolve them of guilt in this situation. You don't have to be mad at them, but still guilty, Mug. Y'all sorry as hell.
Zeke, you can't get a Feed Me tattoo with no signs of a six-pack anymore. Like, what just happened? I saw you at the ESPYs. I saw you coming out in the draft. I saw you with all those. Come on, big dog. It was about my ninth year in the league when I lost my six-pack.
He's in Dallas, though. He eating good.
He eating too good.
That barbecue.
I mean, look, Papados and
all that.
Can you stay off of that? Eat on the field. Don't eat off the field. Zeke, I'm going to pile on a little more before I transition to other parts of this team. Ezekiel Elliott, 6-1 the Cowboys are when he gets over 100 rush yards since last year. We know we got to feed you, but you got to produce when we give you that. Here's another issue. 7 lost fumbles in his last 14. He only has 11 rush touchdowns. I can't keep highlighting how bad Ezekiel Elliott is and make you guys understand it. So let me go to other parts that
Please.
Will couple with him to let you know understand. The defense. Ooh, this defense, poor defense, has to deal with a team that has turned the ball over 15 times. They've already given up 84 points by turnover.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, only 45. You think about it. In 16 games, we gave up 45 points off of those turnovers.
Mm-hmm.
Oski, Oski, Oski. But this year, it's 84. We have a complete issue where everything is starting to implode. And the only thing that was keeping us afloat was the guy that's gone, Dak Prescott. So now I got to pile on you. I got to look at your face right now. I got to look at you and say, who else is to blame of this situation? Andy Dalton. Because Andy Dalton, I know he was thrown into the fire, but with that red hair, I thought he was prepared. And he was not prepared for this. Give me a full screen, because some people all were out there thinking that Andy Dalton was going to be the answer for Dak Prescott and them. Let's see this full screen. We got this? Anybody? Full screen? Andy Dalton? Dak Prescott? Oh, we ain't got it? Okay. Oh, we got it. Oh, is this Dak's agent over here trying to look up? Okay, here we go. This is the difference in who you had at quarterback yesterday. And y'all can see that the numbers on the right don't compare to the numbers on the left. I'm not even going to go through this because I played this full screen for you yesterday. I want to also highlight that we had how many points by Andy Dalton yesterday? Fun fact.
10.
Oh, okay. When Dak Prescott gave you 40, 38, 37,
sure,
31.
Sure.
My point is,
y'all
missed the hell out of Dak covering for Zeke and others.
Sure, but let's say this.
Okay.
Who was going to assume that Zeke would fumble 2 of the first 4 possessions?
Anybody who's been doing their history?
No, Zeke had 2 fumbles on the season. I didn't think he was going to have 2 in the first 14 plays.
Okay,
Because, again, nobody said, the reason I am absolving to a degree Andy Dalton is this. Nobody said Andy Dalton was better than Dak.
No.
And that's what a lot got lost on Twitter. Nobody said Andy Dalton was better than Dak. People said Andy Dalton would be better for the Cowboys than Dak. Why?
Oh, don't hide behind people. I said that.
Along with Jimmy Johnson.
If I'm thinking,
Jimmy, come with me.
You said that.
I said it. But I said it because I was like, great, feed Zeke. I want to see a Dallas Cowboys, Marcellus, where Zeke gets 11 out of the 14 touches.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I apologize if that's wrong of me. But I want to see a Dallas Cowboys team,
yeah,
a Dallas Cowboys offense, where a top 3 running back over the last 5 years, where a running back making $95 million, where a running back selected in the top 5 overall of the first round, I want to see a Cowboys offense where that running back is featured.
You know what's interesting? Your blame game kind of takes me back to Dallas. Let's go back there. NFL Network's Jane Slater had this tweet on the Cowboys earlier today. Quote, Cowboys players initially bought into keeping things internal. Now as they sit 2-4, the discontent is leaking out, like Acho. On the coaching staff, a player said, quote, totally unprepared. They don't teach. They don't have any sense of adjusting on the fly. Another player added, quote, they just aren't good at their job. So Acho, blame game continues. You have an issue with Cowboys players calling out the coaching staff.
Bro, I have absolutely no issue with the players calling out the coaching staff. I have an issue with the anonymity of it. That's me. No, I don't got an issue with it. No. Put an address on it, though, because when you don't put an address on things, they get lost in the mail. You put an address on it, player.
Say it.
Want two things. Number one, who's the player? Because that dictates the legitimacy of the statement.
Mm.
Is a player one of these defensive players getting whooped? Because to me, there are about four players who can make the statement on the team that I would listen
to. Who you got names?
Trayvon Diggs.
Okay.
Zach Martin. CeeDee Lamb, Michael Gallup, Amari Cooper. Five players, excuse me. There are five players on the Cowboys team, and they're 1-2 deep, not counting special teams, who I would listen to that and be like, huh, you know what? You're doing your job, so let me hear what you have to say about other people.
Yeah.
The other thing is very simple for me. There's a double standard in the NFL. Coaches call out players all of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't bat an eye.
That's
man, we got to be better at this position. Got to be better in the kicking game. Got to be better at this. Got to be better at that. So when a player wants to call out a coach, I personally, I'm of the new school. I'm not of the old school. I'm of the new school where I'm like, everybody can get it. Worst case scenario, you put your name on it, you say who it is, they cut you, and you wind up on a better team. So I have no issue, Marcellus, with a player calling out the coach. I have an issue with the anonymity of it.
I hate this all around. I hate that the player didn't put his name on it.
Okay.
I hate that the player didn't say who he's talking about. There are a lot of coaches around.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes, yes.
You talking about the assistant linebacker coach?
Yes.
You talking about the assistant strength coach?
All of that.
Who are you talking about? Because I want to know that. I want this to have a direct focus so it can have a direct impact. But also, I hate it the most because this right here is just some denial. And when you talk about the stages of grief and loss, and they've been losing a whole lot. What's the first stage?
Acho, anybody?
Denial. And isolation. Now, they can't go nowhere. We're going to find you. You got a star on your helmet. So guess what they're going to do? Deny it. I hated the moments that even I, who played with a lesser of an ego than most but still had an ego, was starting to go down the hill when I knew that I wasn't balling out of control. And then I will look in the mirror and say, yeah, I'm about to blame somebody. Somebody else step in this mirror with me, because it ain't going to be me. That's what these players sound like right now. Oh, you going to blame Mike McCarthy? You really going to blame Mike McCarthy? Mike McCarthy, the same coach who has a Super Bowl championship. What player on this team going to sit there with their ring and say, I fight back at you? Oh, you going to blame Mike Nolan, defensive coordinator. Mm-hmm. Oh, really? The same defensive coordinator who had top 10 defenses in one, two, three, four, five different organizations.
It's been a while.
I don't give a damn how long it's been. He has that equity. What player on this team right now that's playing well has that same
equity? Let me tell you why I vehemently disagree with you in this regard.
Okay.
I vehemently disagree with you because don't come here with your past success, particularly if it's been a decade ago, and then try to throw your past success around to make me act like, oh, I should just sit here and reverence you because what you have done in your previous life. Let me tell you my point here.
Okay.
Mike McCarthy, outside of, like I said, outside of Rodgers and outside of Favre, he has a 35% winning percentage, .354. Only 19 other NFL coaches in history have that bad a winning percentage. One of the other 19, defensive coordinator, Mike Nolan. So when, if I'm a Cowboys player, I'm sitting here like, wait a second. If you ain't got two Hall of Fame quarterbacks, you're not even average.
Wow.
You're one of the 20 worst coaches of all time.
Wow.
Now, sure, you can say, well, Phil Jackson, he had Jordan, and Brady, he had Belichick. But even when Belichick didn't have Brady, he was still competent in the last two decades.
I mean, Super Bowl.
So he was, I'm not asking McCarthy to win a Super Bowl. I'm asking McCarthy to not be 1-3.
Okay.
I'm asking McCarthy to not get embarrassed by the Arizona Cardinals.
You ready?
I'm asking Mike Nolan to not give up a historical amount of yards on defense. I'm not even asking them to win a Super Bowl. So I'm not mad at them for calling out these coaches. Don't talk to me about what Mike McCarthy did in 2011 with the Packers in 2010.
Oh, don't talk about that.
What has Mike McCarthy done lately? He got fired in Green Bay, and then he went on sabbatical, and he went and he saw it, and he hid himself in a valley, and he studied analytics. Analytics ain't showing up. So if I'm a player, I understand the frustration.
You know what's funny? What, everyone who wins a championship says they want to win it in part because you can't take it away. But then somebody comes up here
taking
by the name of Emmanuel Acho with his pastel tie would sit there and try his damnedest to take it away. Oh, interesting. I never won a championship, so I'm not in that conversation. But I'm just letting you know that's what they're going to fight back with. And Phil Jackson, he didn't just have Jordan. He had Kobe.
Okay. He had Shaq.
So what's Phil Jackson's record without Jordan and Kobe, like you just did to Mike McCarthy with Aaron Rodgers and Brett Favre? Oh, same.
Definitely not the same.
Actually, it's zero. Because he never coached without them boys. He ain't stupid. Here's the thing about it. Mike McCarthy went into Green Bay first year. What was that team before? 4-12. What was the year when he got them?
I hate when you do this.
I need you to understand process. I know we different in age, but I believe in process, even if it takes time. Tortoise and hare, I bet on the tortoise. You bet on the hare.
And I would win. And I would win every time.
Not my cartoons. I never saw the hare win. But here's the thing, dog. 4-12. And then they were 8-8. But people forget, what were they in that 8-8 year? 2-4. Exactly the same place. 8-8 will win this division. Give me some.
Of course.
And then if you respect the process as the tortoise could do, guess what they were the next year? 13-3 NFC championship but game. Respect
can
process.
But can we have a real conversation, Sel? Because you're being an imposter for the sake of the camera.
You know what?
I should have known.
When you lose an argument, no. You're an imposter.
You got your political tie on, so you out here politicizing. I should have known, America. The man came out here in his blue and his red, and I should have known you was going to try to lie to me like a politician.
Gentlemen, countrymen, lend me an ear.
Lend me your ears. Lend me yours, big bro. Right. It's not just how you lose. You know that. It's not just who you lose to. It is how you lose, excuse me. The Cowboys, if you lose to the Cardinals, I'm not mad. If you lose to the Cardinals, I'm not mad, but you can't get embarrassed 38-10 at home. You can't give up 69-yard touchdown runs when the Cardinals are trying to milk the clock. Cowboys,
yeah,
you can't.
That's real.
If you beat the Falcons, I'm happy. But you can't beat the Falcons because of a lucky onside kick and the Falcons being terrible. It's not just how you win. It's not just who you beat. It's how you win. It's not just who you lose to. It is how you lose. I'm mad at Mike McCarthy and this coaching staff for how they perform. If you didn't know any better, I would let you slide. But you know far greater sit here and say that Mike McCarthy is building. They're not building anything right now.
This
is not looking like something that is being built. This is something that is being torn down.
Oh, look here. Is that their starting quarterback out there?
It's not.
Yo boy, Andy Dalton, red rifle, shooting blanks. Uh-huh. Is that? Okay.
It's not.
So almost I want to give him a mulligan going forward. I tried to tell you this before yesterday's game, but you want to go out there and be with a quarterback that sustains everything instead of enhances everything like Dak Prescott. I have a question for you, Acho. You played a lot of football in your life. Y'all talking to Mr. All-State linebacker right here. Went to UT. Hook 'em horns. Boy, you a beast.
Get to the point.
Are they getting out-schemed or are they getting outplayed? Guess what? Being real, and you've been on this show, and I've seen it, watching that video screen, show me low light after low light. Mm-hmm. Jalen Smith, what are you doing attacking the wrong gap? Jalen Smith, why are you walking on this play? They're not getting out-schemed as much as they're getting outplayed.
That's a hard statement, sir.
I would say
both.
Can a coach make you stop fumbling? No. You know what a coach can do? He can highlight to you the consequences and importance of holding on to that ball. But Ezekiel Elliott's on his own once he stepped between the white lines. How can I coach that? How can I coach the fact that, hey, Gallup, don't drop the ball?
Let's talk ball. Can a coach make a defensive end keep contained? Well, what that is, layman's terms. Can a coach make a defensive end make sure that nobody gets outside of him?
Yes, he can.
I would say yes, he can.
Can
a coach help a quarterback stop throwing interceptions? I think so. I think a coach can help a running back stop fumbling by instilling it in the fact of hold on to the ball.
I hear you. You feel me?
It's the same thing.
It's been a conversation, age-old conversation, of how much is it really the teaching and how much is it really on the student.
Mm-hmm.
And you think about it. When you look at Ezekiel Elliott, what did they say at halftime? They asked Mike McCarthy, what did you talk about with Ezekiel? He said nothing. He understands the importance of it. To me, that makes sense. Ezekiel Elliott is a top player in our league.
Yep.
If you go up to him and say anything about his performance at that time, it's redundant because his self-criticism is louder than anything you're going to say.
How
are you going to blame the coach?
Let me just say one last thing.
Okay.
When talking to a lawyer 5 years ago, he said something that has stuck with me to this
day.
I didn't, thank God. Okay, it was a small dispute, a little small claims court. No Judge Judy, though. He said an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure.
Yeah, that's real.
An ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. Mm. The Cowboys coaches need to give this team an ounce of prevention. Oh. Give Zeke an ounce of prevention. Give Dalton an ounce of prevention. Give the defensive backs an ounce of prevention. Mm. Instead of trying to, at halftime, submit to them a pound of cure. Can the Cowboys coaches keep Zeke from fumbling when he steps onto the field? If you give him that ounce of prevention, I believe so.
It's impossible to coach a player who tells reporters and swears he's never going to fumble again before a game and literally fumbles twice in the first 14 plays. I don't think a coach in the world, including Belichick, can cure that.